Episode 985, My Strength is My Story with Dave Crenshaw, The Power of Having Fun.
Moms, needing a little inspiration and a ray of hope? You've come to the right place. This is the show that you can turn to for just the pick-me-up you need. This is Create Your Now, Your Best Selfie. Here's your host, certified life coach, personal trainer, and nutritionist, Christiane Wargo.
Staring at a stop sign, watching people drive by.
Happy, happy day. It is my favorite day. It is my strength is my story. And guess what? We have a first. It is our first gentleman here on Create Your Now, Your Best Selfie. Dave Crenshaw is with us. And boy, do we have, well, a lot of fun. It's all about the power of having fun. How would your life look like if you had more fun? We go deep. We have an extremely just heart-to-heart fun time. I know you'll enjoy it. For those of you who are brand new to Create Your Now, friends of Dave Crenshaw, welcome to this incredible family. I'm so delighted of your presence. If you already haven't had the opportunity, you'll want to head on over to createyournow.com where you can learn more and to sign up for the Kisses newsletter, the Keep It Simple Strategy Everyday Solutions to Live, Love, and Impact. Well, Dave, a man who's been married 16 years, has three beautiful children. We get real. We get down to earth. And we ask some interesting questions. He has this five-step process. And we share a little bit about it back and forth. He's amazing. You'll want to listen in. So let's do it. Let's dive deep with Dave Crenshaw, The Power of Having Fun. Welcome to Create Your Now. I'm so excited to have a special guest with us today. Oh yes, it is My Strength is My Story series, and we have Mr. Dave Crenshaw here. He is a happily married man of 16 years. Can you believe it? It's awesome. A father to three adorable children. He's an admitted geek, enjoying all things superheroes, and Xbox gamer. I had to throw that in for my kiddos. Mr. Crenshaw is the productive leadership mentor, his expertise as a speaker and business coach. He loves to share with audiences all around the world. He is an author who's written four books, including The Myth of Multitasking and the latest, The Power of Having Fun. Oh yes, how meaningful breaks help you get more done and feel fantastic. Well, Dave, I love to have fun. Welcome.
Thank you so much for having me on.
Oh, well, it's my delight, and anything about fun and Create Your Now, I mean, come on, we've got to do it more often.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's necessary for us to do it more often.
Yes, it is. And we're going to get into that. But before we jump in to the book and what happened and why you wanted to write it, tell us what you're doing right now. What keeps you hopping?
Well, for me, what I love to do is I work with leaders of all kinds. I do some coaching, not as much as I used to. I have a lot of courses online. If you're familiar with lynda.com or LinkedIn Learning,
yes.
I've got about 18 courses on there, the most popular of which is Time Management Fundamentals. Mm. So I'm always responding to questions from students all around the world who have been through it. And then also I travel around and do keynote addresses at events around the world. So I've got a variety of things that I've got to do, but it's all around that idea of helping leaders be more productive.
Mm. And we all need that. And we're leaders even in the household.
Yes, exactly.
Yes.
Yeah, my wife and I believe that very strongly. You know, it's very important for us to be there for our children. Mm-hmm. My wife has the ability to do really anything that she wants to do, but she's chosen to stay at home and to lead our children and to be a good example for them. So, yeah, I completely agree with that.
Well, that's awesome. And you took this plunge. I mean, you wrote the book, The Myth of Multitasking, but then you went even a step further, which when I first got this information, I looked at your book, I'm like, the power of having fun. I mean, isn't that just like something we should naturally be thinking we should be doing?
Right. And the answer is most people don't think that.
Mm-hmm.
Or if they do think it, they do not give it the proper priority. Mm-hmm. For most of us, fun is something that we get to do after we do good work, right? After we work hard, after we complete that project, after we get the dishes done or the laundry or we, you know, whatever it is, mm-hmm. that we're telling ourselves. After I complete this book, then I get to have fun.
Exactly.
But the reality is fun is something that should be a top priority. So, you know, in the you brought up the myth of multitasking. The myth of multitasking is really a book about what you should not do, which is you should not segment your attention into lots of different things. The Power of Having Fun is also a productivity book, but it's about what you should do. And what you should do is spend strategic, scheduled time for a break. I call them oases. You know, if you think about what an oasis is in the middle of a desert, it's a place of refreshment, of rejuvenation. And so many of us deprive ourselves of that rejuvenation and that refreshment after months or years. Or, you know, we think of in terms of vacation, one vacation per year, but that's not enough. We need to be doing it every day. And when we do that, we'll perform better.
How in the crazy world can we take a vacation and have an oasis every single day?
Yeah, great question. And the answer is, first of all, most people think too big. We do not have to do big things. I'll give you an example of one business owner that I worked with. She ran a very successful business, stressed her out, lots of things going on. I talked to her about this principle. So what she decided to do was to take a walk and go visit a friend, in particular, her friend Bessie the cow. That's what she told me. And so what she decided to do was to once a day just go for a 10, 15-minute walk down the hill, go pat Bessie on the nose. This is what she told me word for word. Go pat her on the nose and then come back. And that little moment that she took for herself helped make her be more successful in all the hours, not just after, but before as well, because she had that thing to look forward to.
And it was just a cow, but to her, it was life-changing. It was a moment of refreshment.
Right. And that's the principle that I talk about in the book, where one of the steps that people need to take in order to unlock the power of having fun is they need to rediscover what they used to do for fun. A lot of people, not everyone, but a lot of people, if you ask them, what do you do for fun? They sort of freeze up and nothing comes to mind because they've forgotten how to do that. Yes. Recess was taken from them. And so what we need to do is restore recess to our routines. And so what you do is you look back and you say, what did I used to do for fun? Did I used to like to ride motorcycles? Did I used to like to go gardening? Did I used to like to play video games? Which in my case, that's my daily oasis. I spend 30 minutes on Xbox playing that.
Awesome.
And it doesn't matter whether you're doing something passive, like playing a video game, or active, like going for a run. There are studies that have shown that the results are exactly the same, regardless of the type of activity. So what matters most is what you define as meaningful.
That's key there. What you define as meaningful, because what you see, Dave, as meaningful may not be the same thing for me, because like I'm not a gamer.
Right.
You know, I mean, I'll watch my husband play or I'll watch one of my five children play. But me, no, I crash within the first 5 seconds. Just saying.
Right.
So,
well,
yeah.
my wife just hates it and thinks it's a waste of time. But you know what? That's a good example, though, because my wife, who hates video games, recognizes the value of this. Because what I used to do and what a lot of people do, especially if they work from home, is there's no separation, there's no commute, there's no barrier between work and being at home.
Yes.
And so what I would do is I'd finish my work day and I'd sit down with a dinner or with my children and I'd just kind of be doing this, right?
Right.
Because I hadn't built that transition. So now I put that transition of having fun, which in my case is playing the video games, for half an hour. And it allows me to clear my mind out, flush out all the thinking about the interviews that I had to do today, writing the book, working with a client, whatever it was, and just be focused so that when my children come in at 5 o'clock, I can be there for them. And when I spend time with my wife, I can be there for her. And my wife recognizes the value of that. Not video games, but the value of me having a clear mind. And occasionally, I don't follow my own principle. Right? I'm not perfect.
Surely
and
not.
Sometimes that happens. I'll go downstairs and I'll be sitting there like that. And she will ask the question, did you play video games today? And I'll say, no, I didn't. And she'll say, what's wrong with you? You should have done that. Again, because she recognizes the value of the principle of the power of having fun, but not necessarily the activity.
Right. And you talk about in your book, which, by the way, the book was fascinating. And it was neat because you didn't get all, like, research scientific and throwing, like, 13,000 different studies in my face.
Yeah, there were some there.
Yes, oh, definitely there were. But it was nice because it was a read that I could get and I could apply to my life. And so you all are going to want to pick up your own copy of The Power of Having Fun, How Meaningful Breaks Help You Get More Done and Feel Fantastic. And you want to feel fantastic. Yeah, you're holding up your real book.
Yeah, here's the official one.
That's right. I have the paper copy. I got the advanced copy. And it's just paper. But I still enjoyed every bit of it. But truly, you know, in there, you made it to where anybody, regardless of where they are in their life, this book can apply to them. It's not just the CEO of a Fortune 500 company.
Right. In fact, that's a big point of emphasis in the book is, you know, I talk about the three oases, the personal oasis, the family oasis, and the work oasis. And you need to have a balance between all three of them. And one of the things I talk about in the work oasis is sometimes we get the feeling that our job, if it's not perfect, we're not happy. Mm. If it doesn't fit into everything that we wanted it to be when we imagined it, then it's not right and we need to move on. But the reality is we're in control of our own happiness with work, whatever that work is.
Yes.
Whether it's working at home or working as a CEO or working middle management, we are in control. And we can take control by scheduling these little oases in our day. And it helps us have a renewed perspective when we go back to that work of our choosing.
Mm-hmm. Well, I don't want to jump into the oasis yet, even though being from Hawaii, I so want to get my toes in the sand all the time. And I live up north, so I don't get my toes in the sand. But with the oasis, we've got to come from someplace else. And
right.
That someplace else you call these deserts. It's like a rut, the things that we just kind of, maybe it's our mundane activities, whatever. Talk a little more about the ruts, the deserts that we face.
So my definition of a desert is an extended period of time of deprivation and or chaos as defined by you. So a few examples of deserts. Probably it doesn't apply to everyone, but one of the most common is work.
Yes.
And every desert has to have the other side of the desert, mm-hmm. meaning for work, it's retirement, right? When I reach that side, then everything will be okay. But in the meantime, I have to trudge through this. I have to push through this. I just saw a study, I can't remember what it was from, it just came out, said that the average age at which people begin to not like work is 35.
Really?
Yeah, that's the point. So everybody is optimistic about work, and then they hit 35, and then it's all downhill. And so what we have to do is we have to find the oasis in the midst of that desert. Or perhaps your desert could even be, you know, my wife and I, we love our children. I love my three children. I've got a 12-year-old, an 8-year-old, and a 4-year-old. But anyone who's a parent also recognizes the sweet relief that happens when they stop yelling and screaming and running around the house. And it's like, go outside and play. Go down in the basement and play, right? Just go away for a little bit. That can sometimes be a desert, right? Even though it's something that you love, it's a period where you are depriving yourself of the very things that you need in order to rejuvenate yourself. They're just a variety of deserts. I don't know how many people you have that own their own business, but sometimes it's like, well, when I sell my business, then everything's going to be great. I refer to all of this as the culture of wish,
mm-hmm.
and the culture of wish stands for all of this will be worth it someday, hopefully.
Mm.
And we get into that mindset. It'll be worth it someday, hopefully. When you hear yourself saying that to yourself, that is a good sign that you are in a desert and you need to start transitioning your mindset.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Yeah, it's just like you have this attitude of, I'm just loading the trucks. You know, I just got to keep loading the trucks and just getting through the day.
Yes.
Because 25 years from now, I know I'll be done.
Right. And that is, in fact, we think that is the mindset of hard work. Mm-hmm. That's what people who are successful do. But in reality, what it is doing is it's depriving us of the very thing that will help us be successful.
Mm-hmm.
You need to have little tidbits of fun. In fact, you know, you said I didn't use many studies, but here's one that was really relevant, which was a study in mice where they performed an activity where they had to escape from water. And they had two groups. One group was deprived of dopamine. Dopamine is the chemical that your body naturally creates. It's a drug that your body creates when good things happen, when you have fun, when you relax, when you do these oases that we're talking about. Mm-hmm. So one group was deprived of dopamine, mm-hmm. and the other group had regular injections of dopamine. The group that was deprived of dopamine, their scores got worse over time. In other words, by repetitively doing something over and over and over, they didn't get better at it, they got worse at it. Whereas the ones who got the dopamine continued to improve their scores with repetition. So when you think about being in that desert and whatever it is that you're doing repetitively over and over and over again, if you do not take time to have fun, you're not getting better over time, you're getting worse. Your performance will degrade. So you need to take these moments. It's not a get to for good behavior. It's not something you deserve. It's something you require.
Yes. I love that. And, you know, it got me thinking, we're so high tech now with social media even, and like everything is just a blink at our fingertips. And I think about the people who take, quote unquote, the breaks, who maybe make time, but where they go to and where they find themselves is Facebook or Instagram or, you know, Snapchat or whatever. That may give them a little burst of an oasis, but I think, honestly, I think it may actually sink them deeper in the desert because they're not getting the oasis that is actually feeding them personally.
Yeah, they're seeing other people's oasis, which is why I think most of us have heard of by now, a lot of studies show that people are more depressed after spending time in social media because we're seeing what other people are doing that's great. And that's not what my book is talking about. What my book is talking about is figuring out what is great for you, whatever that is, and making time for yourself to enjoy it, not by watching others post up pictures on their Pinterest page.
Yes, excellent point. Excellent point. Y'all need to be listening. You're going to want to pick up your own copy of The Power of Having Fun, How Meaningful Breaks Help You Get More Done and Feel Fantastic. We will have the link for you in the show notes. And I'm telling you, the hard copy is going to be better than my paper copy. Just saying. There it is. Yes, you got it. Oh, okay. So now that we know what our desert is, we have this idea of maybe where we're suffering. We're dehydrated. We're, you know, gosh, yeah. In your book, you talk about going and making a list as to what we did when we were growing up to having fun. And that you led into the oasis. Talk a little bit about that.
Yeah. So one thing that I did that was kind of fun was I surveyed a whole lot of children all across the United States from a variety of different socioeconomic backgrounds and asked them, what do they like to do for fun? Now, the purpose behind this, I know that there are some people who are big a fan of, you know, you need to embrace your inner child, that sort of thing. I'm a practical guy. I work with productive leaders. So I'm not a big, like, I don't think we should jump on trampolines while using a sippy cup and eating Oreo cookies. That's not where I'm coming from with this.
May make a great American, you know, funniest video type thing.
Yeah, yeah. Well, and hey, if that's what's fun for you, then great, do it. But what's more important is that we remember what we used to do for fun and then find the adult equivalent. For example, you know, I'm looking at the list right now of what some of the children said. You know, they said like watch TV, play with pets. They like to learn, go on vacation, play with toys, play at a park, go outside. So let's take that one, play at the park. All right. Well, all right. Going as an adult and swinging on the swings. Hey, if you want to do that, go right ahead. But I think most adults are not comfortable with doing that. And if you do it by yourself, you'll probably get taken away. So what's an equivalent of that? Well, maybe I could go find a local beach, or maybe I could go, you know, start mountain biking, right? There are adult equivalents of what you used to do for fun. I used to play with Legos, right? What are adult equivalent of Legos? Well, Maybe I build a really complex train set. Or even maybe I'm like Will Ferrell in the Lego movie. I build a Lego set, but it's like, you know, to a big level.
Right.
That's what I'm talking about, mm-hmm. is remembering, you know, think back 5, 10, 15, 20 years ago. Remember what you used to do for fun, and then ask yourself, what could I do now that's like that? And that helps restart the brain in terms of thinking about making fun a priority. Mm.
Yeah, because we really forget what it's like to have fun because of all of our responsibilities, our duties of the day.
Yeah. Yeah. Somewhere along the line, someone stole recess from us. Mm-hmm. Think about that. At what age did you stop getting to have recess of some kind? Mm. Usually it happens somewhere around high school, right?
Yes. And now it's much earlier.
Yeah, yet that doesn't mean that it shouldn't still happen. Mm-hmm. A great example, there is a company that in fact has adult recess. It's Kiva.org. I don't know if you've done anything with Kiva. Great organization. I've done micro-lending with them. It's a lot of fun to help people around the world with micro-lending. Mm-hmm. Fantastic company. And one of the things they do is they have a scheduled time where people stop work for 20 minutes or so, take a break, enjoy a snack, and they even have games and activities that people can do. You don't have to do them, but the option is there. Mm. And, we go back to that desert mindset.
Yes.
You know, I mentioned how a lot of people think that it's something you deserve. Mm. If you're in the desert, do you deserve water? In other words, do you get a drink of water for good behavior at the end of your journey?
I need it.
Yeah, exactly. It's a necessity. Yeah. It is a requirement for mm-hmm. success. Having fun in the way that I'm talking about is the very same thing. Mm. This is a requirement, and you must make it a part of your schedule every single day.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so we've got the culture of wish, worth it someday, hopefully, right? Wait, did I get that right?
Yeah, worth it someday, hopefully. Hopefully.
Okay, just making sure. And then you talk about how you move into the culture of win.
Yeah, yeah. And the culture of win is that it's worth it now. Mm. Everything that you're doing, it shouldn't just be worth it someday when I retire, someday when my kids move out, someday when, you know, we have all these things of we're going to be happy when, right? Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And what I'm saying is, no, we need to make it worth it now. Every single day, you should have an oasis. Mm-hmm. Once a week, you should have an oasis. And I'm going to say this because I know your audience is mostly women. Uh-huh. You should have an oasis for yourself and an oasis for your family. You see the emphasis on this. Mm-hmm. Because my experience when I coach executives, both men and women, is that they're really good at emphasizing one or the other. In other words, they're probably already taking oasis with their family on a regular basis. But then I say, well, what are you doing for yourself, by yourself? Mm-hmm. Blank stare, no response, right?
Yep.
Both need the benefit. Yeah. You need the personal recharging so that you can be successful with everything else that you're doing. Mm-hmm. And those people who have made the sacrifice to help you be successful, those you love most, also need time with you. Mm-hmm. If we take time for both, then we're balancing the equation. And we're going to get the maximum benefit of the power of having fun. Mm.
Love it. We need to have more fun. And with what's sometimes happening in our world, really scheduling that time. So I'm a busy mom. I'm a mom of five. Mm-hmm. You say I'm supposed to schedule my oasis.
Mm-hmm.
How do I get to that point? Because if you were to look at my schedule, you would probably run the other way.
Well, the first thing that I think will make it more realistic is understanding that I am talking about brief moments. Mm-hmm. So, you know, when I talk about this, and occasionally people are like, oh, my schedule's too busy. I'll say, no, wait a minute. Can you take, you tell me you can't take 10 minutes out of your schedule somewhere, right? Can you take 10 minutes out of your schedule somewhere?
I can. I'll find
okay.
it.
Okay.
I can.
So that, let's start with that. Okay. 10 minutes. And you're going to put it into your calendar. You're going to say, all right, yes, I know it's going to be crazy from after I do work and then the kids come home. So where's that moment in between the two? And let's schedule 10 minutes right there. Or if that's not practical, what about 10 minutes before lunch or 10 minutes after lunch, mm-hmm. right?
Right.
Something like that. And then putting it in the calendar. And that is so key. We put appointments in our calendar with VIPs. We, you know, whether that's family members or it's a best customer or whatever it is, but we also need to schedule these for us.
Yes.
And we need to respect them just as much as we would an appointment with a VIP.
Mm-hmm. I totally agree. And it's so easy for us to let that go and to not take care of those little things of the oasis. And that's really what I loved about your book, Dave, when in reading it, was that it wasn't about that I had to go and capture like a whole vacation in 10 minutes. But over right. time of a week, it was like taking a whole vacation because my productivity continued to increase over time, which made me feel good, raised my confidence, my self-esteem. Love it, love it, love it.
Yeah. Yeah, I had an experience that occurred while I was writing this book. My father passed away at the age of 80, and he this happened in December. And elsewhere in my courses, I talk about how I'm inherently one of the most disorganized people in the world. I've learned to overcome it, but all you had to do was go through his house after he passed with my brother and sister to understand the genetic stock that I came from. It was seriously a nightmare. Mm-hmm. I've done on-site trainings where I've helped people get organized and more productive. By far the worst thing I've ever seen. Mm-hmm. And so I set this backdrop as basically saying, here was a desert that I was in mm-hmm. with my brothers and sisters of, we've got to go through this house and clean everything out and throw everything away that isn't good mm-hmm. and then keep everything that we need to. And this is just going to take us forever. And you start to get in that mindset of, I'm just going to plow ahead. I'm just going to get this done. Mm-hmm. And I caught myself doing that. And so what I did was I decided to take strategic breaks throughout the day. And typically, and by the way, there's research behind this, about 90 to every 120 minutes is a good time for a work break. Mm. And so I would take these little breaks at about the 90-minute mark, and I'd take a 10-minute break. And I could tell that there was a little bit of misunderstanding of the people around me. I'm like sitting here just kicking back, drinking a Dr. Pepper while they're doing hard work.
Yeah.
But by doing that, it gave me more longevity. Mm-hmm. It gave me the ability to hang in there longer for doing this difficult work. Mm-hmm. And we were able to clear out the house in a day, something that should have taken a week.
Whoa.
And to me, that was just a personal example of, hey, what I'm teaching people to do is reality. Mm-hmm. You can get more done when you have time for fun. Mm-hmm.
And even because you gave yourself that oasis, those little breaks, it also gave you refreshment within your soul, your spirit, your emotions. I mean, you were wrapped up losing your father. I lost my father 5 years ago at the age of 65. And it's very hard.
Yeah, that's very young too.
Yes, and it's very fresh though still for you, Dave. And so going in there and going through all of that, that should have taken about a week.
Right.
I mean, the average, but to get it done in a day, but yet you were able to sustain yourself and keep yourself emotionally stable to get through it, because you can stop there and pause and then just all of a sudden you're just like crying oceans, and then you are fine and you may be laughing at a joke, and then next thing you know you're crying oceans, yet you got all of that done in a day.
Right. And that's an extreme example, but we all have things that we're going through that are difficult and that are hard.
Yes.
Every day, every week, we have moments like that. Mm-hmm. And again, the temptation is to think, if I just put my head down and I keep plowing, I'm going to get this done. I'm a fan of hard work. I'm a big believer in it. Okay. I do think that people need to work hard.
Yes.
But doing it relentlessly without a fun break is counterproductive. Mm-hmm. If you take those fun breaks, you will get it done more, you'll get more done, and you'll get it done faster. Mm-hmm. And that's the paradox of the power of having fun.
Oh, love it, love it. You're going to want to pick up your own copy of The Power of Having Fun, How Meaningful Breaks Help You Get More Done and Feel Fantastic. I'm feeling fantastic already. It really is a great book. I think this, what I noticed in reading the book, Dave, is I homeschooled my children for years. I put them, they've been in private schools, traditional schools, and now my children range from age of 21 down to the age of, I guess, 13. So I'm no longer of elementary children. They're all teens or older.
Congratulations.
Thank you. But what I noticed is that in reading your book, I took in more, not only just myself as a mom, but as a woman, as a businesswoman, as an entrepreneur, as a mom that can help her children and can, you know, and say, look, you got these five steps, or was it seven? I forgot.
Five. You got
five.
It.
Okay, five.
You nailed it.
I was associating it with my children. One step for each of them. And so, and so, you know, I was like, oh, I can do this, because we all have challenges. And whether you're a mom or dad, a husband or wife, a daughter or a son, we all need to be having fun. And
yeah.
I love that. And your win, you know, worth it now? I mean, come on, guys. What are we waiting for? Aren't you worth it?
Right. And we don't have to spend a lot of money. We don't have to spend a lot of time. That's the key, too.
Yes.
I draw a reference to the bucket list, right? We've all heard of the bucket list.
Yes.
Well, the problem with the bucket list is these are all things that are huge and are time consuming and are expensive. Mm-hmm. Look, there's nothing wrong with going and doing some of those things, but tying the happiness of your life and saying, well, when I accomplish that, then it will be cool. That in and of itself is a desert. Mm-hmm. And there are lots of little things that we can do that don't take time, don't take a lot of money or any money at all, mm-hmm. that can rejuvenate ourselves and help us feel happy right now, today.
Mm-hmm. So give us a little example of your life, Dave, a picture as to, in your day, how do you schedule your oasis? What does it look like in these little snapshots here and there?
Okay. Well, I already mentioned the one oasis, which happens at the end of my day. So that's I typically start work somewhere around 9 o'clock. Mm-hmm. So I already know that I have what I call the finish line. So at 5 o'clock each day, that's when I stop. I'm not going to check voicemail, email, anything. Mm-hmm. So at 4:30 each day, that's when I stop work. I'm not allowed to do any kind of work other than to sit on my couch and, you know, play whatever the video game of the moment is that's catching my attention.
Yes.
At 5 o'clock, my children knock on the door. They throw the door open now. And they say, Daddy, let's eat. And we have early dinner with us. So there are two things there. One is the oasis of me personally. Mm-hmm. The other is the oasis for my family, knowing that they're going to get me during that time. And every evening after my children go to bed, my wife and I just hang out and spend time with each other, mm-hmm. doing whatever we want to do, right?
Right.
And my wife knows that she can count on that. So we've got a couple of daily oases there, both personal and family. Mm-hmm. Then on a weekly basis, my wife and I always have a date. We schedule our dates to occur on Saturday afternoon, and that is consistent. And by the way, I talk about that in the book. There are studies about that show that when a couple goes on a date once a week consistently, they are three times more likely to report a happy marriage. They are three times more likely to report better communication. They are three times more likely to report better satisfaction in the bedroom. This one act of just having consistent time together radically changes marriages. And it seems such a simple thing to me, yet when I work with my clients, I am shocked at how often or how few of them do anything like this.
Yep.
Maybe they go out once per month. In fact, there's another study that shows 18% of couples go out once per month. So wow. you think about the value of that oasis. Mm-hmm. That's one thing that we do. And then on a monthly basis, I try to make sure that I have one date with each of my children, one-on-one. So it's not practical for me to think I'm going to have one-on-one time with my little children like I'm, you know, Danny from Full House. It's just not going to happen. It's not going to happen every day. But I can schedule time with them once a month. And I can say, hey, Stratton, what do you want to do? And whatever he wants to do, that's what we're going to do. I can say, Ella, what do you want to do? And one example from the book is I say, Ella, what do you want to do? I want to have a tea party. So I'm sitting on the floor with her having a tea party with My Little Pony and stuff. And, you know, that's not an oasis for me personally, but it sure is for her. Because she knows she can count on that time with Dad. So I don't know. Does that give you an idea of kind of how that works?
Yes, it does. And I think that's so important because, especially from the dad perspective, dads sometimes get all hung up in the productivity. Mm-hmm. That if I'm not working, then I am not succeeding. I am not doing what I was called to do because I'm supposed to, you know, go out and, you know, make the money and bring it home and, you know, mom's going to be there waiting. But then what happens is, yes, the marriage suffers over time. And, you know, I just love that you're coming. I mean, you didn't write from that perspective in your book directly to a father, but I love with your examples and what you do in your family that we can take this beyond the CEOs, the CFOs, the Fortune 500 companies,
right,
and take it into our daily, weekly, monthly, yearly life, and it is a game changer.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's funny because even that mindset of, you know, that you mentioned men have, and I do see it more with men in particular, is the idea that, well, in the end, I'm doing this for my family, and then I will have more time with my family.
Yes.
That is the culture of wish. Mm-hmm. That is a desert. Mm-hmm. And it's false.
Yes.
Not only can there are moments that you can never make up, mm-hmm, right? I can't make up a first step. I can't make up a first word. I can't make up going to my daughter's dance recital, right? Mm-hmm. They're just things that you're never going to reclaim. And we must make time for them now. Mm. But not only must we do it, but we'll be more successful because of it.
Yes.
And that's why the first step in the process is permission. I need to help people understand that they have permission to play and to do these things. Mm-hmm. Because so many people feel guilty when they're having fun. It's a natural tendency for a lot of people. So I need to remove that guilt. And that's really what the book is all about, is that first step, removing that guilt and helping you understand this is a requirement for your day.
And when you pick up your own copy of The Power of Having Fun, in the very back, you will be able to, well, I'm not going to tell you what it is because you got to pick up a copy first. You will have graduated and you will have been given permission, and you could even hang it on your wall. I should have brought mine in with me, but I actually did print it off. I thought it was kind of fun.
Yeah, yeah.
It was awesome.
I like the idea of putting it in your wallet, the license to have fun.
Yes, yes, that is great. And you could even shrink it down and then you could take it to like a place and have it laminated, then you could have it forever. You know, why not?
Yeah.
Oh, I love this, Dave, and you taking the time to kind of put this all together. So you've laid out the culture of wish, which I believe a lot of us are living in. I mean, we're just so there. Male or female, we are living in the wish land.
Mm-hmm.
But we need to, you know, kind of transform ourselves into the win. Worth it now, because all of us, each and every one of us, are fearfully and wonderfully made, and we're worth it now, not just tomorrow, not 30 years from now. You're worth it now.
Right, right. There's no reason to put it off, and that's what I want to do, is remove the excuses that people give themselves. Mm-hmm. I don't have enough time. I don't have enough money. I don't have enough, you know, whatever it is. We don't need time. We don't need money. We don't need all those things. You can take these moments in the pocket, here and there, a little bit everywhere, no matter what your circumstance is.
Mm-hmm. Now, I know the buzzword out there a lot is work-life balance.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like one of these hot things. How is The Power of Having Fun different from this work-life balance buzz that's out there?
Yeah. Well, first of all, there's an implication with work-life balance that it's a balance of time, and that's just not realistic for a lot of people. Instead, what I emphasize is the oasis balance. So I mentioned the personal oasis. I mentioned the family oasis for your loved ones. And then there's the work oasis. And what I want people to do is have the balance of those three together, like a three-legged stool. Mm. And when you have all three of those working together, that's really where you start to experience the power of the culture of win. Mm-hmm. Because you feel that you are at balance. You feel that you are achieving something in all aspects of your life, no matter where you are. Mm-hmm. And I believe it was Tony Robbins who said, you know, it isn't success that makes people happy, it's progress. And having these moments of fun help us experience that kind of progress on a repeated basis. Mm-hmm. You asked about my schedule. It's hard for me to justify a statement that I'm going to make here, but understand that, you know, I'm coaching executives, I'm coaching business owners, and a lot of people, so I see what they do. Mm-hmm. I accomplish far, far more in a roughly 35-hour work week than many people accomplish in four weeks of working 50 or 60 hours. Mm-hmm. And a big reason behind that is because I have the balance of all three. Because I have the confidence and because I have the reservoir of strength that comes from spending time with family, because I have the relaxation and the creativity and the focus that comes with taking time for myself. Mm-hmm. These are all things that everyone can experience in any situation. You don't have to deprive yourself of these things. Mm-hmm. Do it and you'll be more successful.
So I'm brand new to all of this. What would be my first thing? Kind of set me up to say, okay, I'm game. I'm all in. I'm ready to have fun. I love fun. What would you tell me to do?
Okay, well, so that's assuming that number one, you have permission.
Oh, yes.
And number two, you have a clear understanding of you've discovered what is fun. Those are the first two steps.
Okay.
So then we're on scheduling. So now what I would say is, all right, let's create the schedule. Let's pull open your calendar and let us actually see you put in there whatever activity it's going to be. So if you look at my calendar, it says 4:30, play video games, right? That's what I would want to see in your schedule, is the time scheduled and the specific activity. That's another key, because if you don't put it in there, then what happens is sometimes people go, the time arrives and they go, oh, I don't know what to do. And so what's easiest to do? Just keep working.
Yep.
Yeah, so let's put something specific in there. In fact, I would try to do the same thing over and over for 3 weeks. Mm-hmm. Okay? And then at the end of the 3 weeks, let's reassess it and say, all right, did that work for you? Would you change it? Would you add more variety? But just getting you into the habit of doing it is most important. And it sounds weird, but we talk about habits a lot,
yes.
Right? The habit of exercise, the habit of a diet, the habit of sleep, all these things. They're all hard things, right? What I'm saying is I want you to create the habit of fun and get into the rhythm of having fun and make that something that you're comfortable doing. That's where I would start.
Yeah. Awesome. All right. So y'all are taking notes, right? Because you got to be taking notes because you're going to take notes, and then you're going to pick up your own copy of The Power of Having Fun, How Meaningful Breaks Help You Get More Done and Feel Fantastic. Dave, this has been so awesome. I love that you're here, and I can't wait to share your story and get it out more.
Thank you.
Because we really do. I don't know what it is. We get more high tech, but I think we get less tech in our foundation of building a life that we were really created to be living. And, you know, we're more worried about, did I get this degree or am I getting this recognition and all of this? And then when we get it, then what's left? A failed marriage, no relationship with your children, because you were always working towards that instead of working for something very fundamental that we all need.
Well, and you bring up an interesting thing with technology. You know, the fifth step in the process is enjoyment. And understand, I am a huge geek. I love technology. I love computers. I was so thrilled. I just got a new OLED TV. I was just like freaking out about it. I love technology.
Yes.
The problem with technology isn't that it's bad. It's that we're using it incorrectly.
Yes.
And one of the ways in which we use it incorrectly is we're allowing it to constantly pepper us with interruptions, with information here, there, everywhere. We can't just take a moment to do nothing, right? Mm-hmm. And when you do that, what you're doing is you're deconditioning your mind to enjoy life. Mm. Like the business owner that I talked to, she told me about something great that happened in her company. Mm-hmm. And she started talking about it for about a couple of minutes. And then she immediately went into that and started talking about, but it's a problem because we're going to have to hire more people and we're going to have to do this. And I just said, whoa, 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 stop for a second. Mm-hmm. Something good just happened to you. Yeah. Can you just sit with that for a minute? Can you just take that in and feel how that feels to accomplish what you just accomplished? She was like, you're right. I always do that. I always have to just move to whatever's next. And I really think that a part of that isn't that people don't have good intentions. I think a lot of people have good intentions to live a full life and to have balance. But we're just so conditioned because we're so used to just jumping to the next thing that yes. we're not giving our brain and our heart time to take it in of what's happening.
Mm-hmm. Very good point. And one that I think we all really need to kind of chew on and sit with for a while because it's just important overall, not just even the power of fun, but when you bring all of this together, that's when you have balance. That's when you have a solid foundation where you can live your life. Your self-esteem is skyrocketing. Your confidence is there. You're ready to conquer the world, and you're going to have storms. So when those storms present themselves, you're like, okay, I can go with this. I can do it. I can get by. I mean, you showed it even with the loss of your father.
Right. Mm. We have to strengthen, I call it the enjoyment muscle. We have to strengthen it again because so many people have forgotten not just how to have fun, but when great things happen to them, have forgotten how to take them in and experience them. And so that's another part of it too, because I want to make sure that we go beyond just taking the action. I want to make sure that we're taking it internally as well. Mm-hmm. And you know, again, I'm not a touchy-feely guy. I don't come from as it's sometimes said, a woo-woo place. I'm coming from a very practical place,
yes.
which is the brain chemistry involved behind this. If you do not take time to enjoy it, then you're weakening your mind and its ability to find more success. But if you take the time to take it in and to enjoy it, and to acknowledge what's happening, then you're strengthening those neural pathways and it's making your desire and your ability to achieve success even greater.
Drop the mic. I think you hit it right there. I'm telling you, the power of having fun, how meaningful breaks help you get more done and feel fantastic. Mr. Dave Crenshaw, what an incredible book. A great story and one that all of us need to take to heart. Thank you so very much.
Thank you for the opportunity to share.
Well, I know a lot of people are going to want to find you, get in touch with you. Obviously, we're going to have all the links in the show notes, but I want them to hear from you where they can find you.
Well, the easiest place is my main website, davecrenshaw.com. Crenshaw is C-R-E-N-S-H-A-W. And you can, I do a weekly video series right now. I'm responding to questions to people. So I get questions from all around the world and they call it Ask Dave. And then I put up a response. So I send that out once a week. You can find out about there. And then you can get all the details on the book, Power of Having Fun, just powerofhavingfun.com.
Awesome. Awesome. Well, we will have all of that information in the show notes because I know you're going to want to connect with Dave. And I really do appreciate you taking the time. Thank goodness we were able to fit it in before your gaming oasis.
Yes. Yep.
Thank goodness. Anything that you want to leave our audience with?
I always want to leave with action. And so for me, what I would say is if you listen to this, don't just go, that was really great. And, you know, here's some great thing I learned. What I want you to think about is what's one thing that you can do as a result of what you just heard? And then do that one thing. Because if you do that, then it tattoos it onto your life. It makes what you just heard a part of who you are. And then it will make it easier to take the next step. So don't worry about all the things that we said today. Just pick one thing, do that one thing. And then, you know, I'll feel like it was our time together was worth it.
Awesome. Thank you so much for your time. It has been a privilege to have you on. I can't wait to have you back again for another book or just a chat about fun and maybe a few games too.
Sure. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Feeling inspired, ready to train for life and love your journey? Visit createyournow.com for more incredible resources to help you along the way. We'll see you next time on Create Your Now, Your Best Selfie. And remember, always be sure you consult your physician before beginning any health and fitness plan.